Early in the course, we linked linear transformations to matrices. And let's have a quick look at that again. If you have a linear transformation that maps a vector from Cm into Cm, and now that we're going to be talking about the algebraic eigenvalue problems, the matrices are always going to be square, so therefore the length of the input vector must be equal to the length of the output vector. Then if this transformation is a linear transformation, then we know that we can write y is equal to L of x instead as y is equal to a times x, where a is the matrix that captures what our linear transformation does. Okay. Now, in the launch for this week, we talked about if we just view our problem in the right basis, then life is so much more beautiful. Okay, now what does that mean? Well, remember that doing a change of basis is the same, can be viewed as saying, let's multiply by the identity matrix. And what this here then really gives are the coefficients that you use to take a linear combination of the columns of matrix X. So X is now a matrix that is m by m. And then similarly, we can take our vector X and view it in the same basis, and we get this right here. And what that means is that this right here is our new view of X in our new basis. We'll call it X hat. And this here is our new view of our vector Y in our basis that are the columns of the matrix X. And we'll call it Y hat. And if we then bring X to the other side, what we notice is that Y hat is equal to X inverse AX X hat. Okay. So what we really have done is we've taken our linear transformation, viewed it as a matrix, and now noticed that if we view that linear transformation in a new basis, we can think of that as taking the matrix that's associated with the linear transformation, hitting it on the left with X inverse, and hitting it on the right with X. We're going to call that a similarity transformation. Okay? So this now really is the matrix that represents the transformed linear transformation viewed in the new basis. Now let's play with this a little bit. And let's just look at this new matrix right here. What we said was, gee, wouldn't it be nice if this were diagonal? Okay. Wouldn't it be nice if there was a matrix, let's call it capital lambda, that was this right here, because then all of a sudden everything falls nicely in place. And isn't it much nicer to multiply with a diagonal matrix than it was to multiply with sort of an arbitrary matrix? Okay, well, let's have a look at that. What that then means is that X inverse times A times X is equal to lambda. All right? We can rewrite that as A times X is equal to X times lambda. Now, what do we like to do in this course? Well, we like to take matrices and bust them up by columns. And we already talked about the fact that X was the matrix where its columns were the basis vectors that we were using to express our vector in the new basis. So, let's take our X and let's partition it into its columns. And let's do this on both sides. But notice two things. We need to do something with lambda because we need to be able to do this times that plus this times that, etc. And we also need to be able to then eventually set columns on this side equal to columns on that side. And that leads me to figure out that I should take my diagonal matrix and I should view it by elements, and then the rest of these, of course, are zero. This here on the left is just a matrix that consists of the first column, the second column, and so forth. Right? Matrix times a matrix that's partitioned by columns is just that matrix times the first column, that matrix times the second column, and so forth. On the right, we see that the first column is this times that plus zero times blah, blah, blah. And therefore, the first column on the right ends up being x0 times lambda 0. But notice that a vector times a scalar is the same as the scalar times the vector. So we get lambda 0 times x0, lambda 1 times x1, and so forth. Interesting. If we now equate columns on the left to columns on the right, what we find that A times XI is equal to lambda I times XI. And lo and behold, that's something that you recognize from your earlier linear algebra course, because what this here says is that lambda I should be an eigenvalue of matrix A, and x of I should be a corresponding eigenvector of that matrix. Okay. So what that means is that this very useful concept of diagonalizing a matrix, which, by the way, you can't do for every matrix, but for a lot of them, can be transformed into the computation of eigenvalues and eigenvectors of that matrix. What we've noticed before is that it's often good to be able to look at the same problem in different ways. And it turns out that it helps to initially look at this problem as finding eigenvalues and corresponding eigenvectors. And then later we can return and talk about what this means about diagonalization.